just for this opportunity and privilege to come and just to study your word one more time. Mm-hmm. We thank you, Father God, for the Spirit of God being here to give us insight and revelation of the word into our lives. And so we just want to honor you. We want to praise you. We give you glory and honor for all that you do, yes, for all that you are to us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
All right, so we've been sharing with you on the main topic of moving forward. And we've been giving you some subtopics. But we said moving forward is a faith connection. It requires faith to move forward. Mm-hmm. If you're a person that's driven by what you see, you probably won't go very far when it comes to God, because there will always be something in front of you that will try to deter you from doing the thing that God has called you to do. So this is what we're going to look at this morning, and we're going to deal with praise, an important key to moving forward. You know, the Lord gave me this statement. I thought it was good, and just something I confess for myself, and that is, I will not despise where I am on my journey to where I will be.
All right.
You know, a lot of times we despise where we are, and we think that when I get to this point, then I'll be happy. You know, I'll have joy. I'll be good then. Right. And we're always chasing the white rabbit, you know. But yet, you know, God wants us to be happy right now. God wants us to be able to praise Him right now in the midst of whatever we're facing, in the midst of whatever we're dealing with. God wants us to have the ability to raise our hands and to give Him thanks. This is because we know that our Father loves us, that He's good to us, and that He cares about us, amen, and He has a wonderful plan for our lives.
Good.
Can anybody say amen to that?
Amen.
Amen. So we say that our praise life must move beyond mental assent into revelation of God's word concerning our lives. In other words, we can know what the word says, we can know what God has said out of His word, but if that does not move you to a place of obedience, to where you would do what He says.
Right.
You know, you can have $1 million idea, but if you never execute it, guess what? Mm-hmm. You're going to still be broke. Though you have a million, because $1 million idea needs some you to move forward to bring that thing to pass.
Mm-hmm. All right.
And that's the thing about God that I always love about that. When He calls us to something, He always sets something before us.
All right.
That keeps us moving. You know, and the thing about God, you have to understand, He's not going to explain the process.
Nope.
He'll tell you where He's taking you. But He never tells you about what you're going to go through in the process of trying to get there. And the reason is because He wants you to focus in on what He has said He would do in the end result, so that whatever comes along in the process won't stop you from doing what He's called you to do.
All right.
A lot of people stop because of the process.
All right.
But we're supposed to be focused on the promise.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Why did Israel not make it to the promised land? Why did that first generation die in the wilderness? Because they could never get beyond the process. Mm-hmm. And they kept losing sight of the promise. Amen. And so will we if we lose sight of what God has called us to do. Let me say this. Genuine praise always propels us forward into the will of God. It is not just singing songs. Remember, genuine praise always propels us forward into the will of God.
Mm.
Not our wills, but His will. And it's not just singing songs, praise God. Singing songs is good. Hallelujah. Thank God for the songs that have been written, and songs we call praise songs. But really, the truth of the matter is that's really not what praise is. That's an expression of praise, but that is not the heart of praise.
Right.
And I think if we're going to be able to effectively praise God in the terms of lifting our hands, we've got to understand what real praise comes from.
Right.
Because I think a lot of times people don't know. We have tied praise to emotionalism, to just running, jumping, and shouting.
Mm-hmm.
But that's really not the heart of praise.
Mm-hmm.
Amen? Mm-hmm. So we're going to kind of deal with that this morning and talk a little bit about that. Mm-hmm. Look at Isaiah chapter 25.
Mm-hmm.
Isaiah chapter 25. We're going to look at verse number 1. And I'm going to read this first from the God's Word translation, then I'm going to read it from the King James translation. They just read it a little differently, but it'll help us get a little more insight of this verse. In Isaiah chapter 25, verse 1, this is what the God's Word translation says. It says, O Lord, You are my God. I will highly honor You. I will praise Your name. You have done miraculous things. You have been completely reliable in carrying out Your plans from long ago. Come on, amen. I like the way that reads. you have been completely reliable in carrying out your plans from long ago. You know, sometimes when God gives you a call, you know, he may meet you at 16 and tell you something. You might not see it come to pass till you're 40.
All right. Mm.
So what are you going to do between 16 and 40? Are you going to go, when God win, why God got, why? Where God, where? Are you going to be praising him the whole time through?
Ooh.
Just holding fast to the promise. Amen? Mm-hmm. Now, the King James reads it this way. It says, O Lord, thou art my God. I will exalt thee. I will praise thy name, for thou hast done wonderful things. Thy counsels of old are faithfulness and truth. Now, let's talk about exalt for me. He talks about exalting God, because I think what we take praise and just categorize it into music. But I think many times people are taking praise and pimped it. come on, now, y'all gonna tell the truth. Folk be rolling around on the church floor, get up and go out and sing like the devil.
Yeah.
That's not praise. All right, so let's talk about exalting. The word exalt means to be highly, to be high actively, to raise or raise, to lift up. So when we talk about exalting God, it talks about lifting him up. Now, how do we lift him up?
Whoo!
See, isn't that the key? Because the church has been taught that we lift Jesus up by singing songs. Mm-hmm. Lift the Savior, we get the movement going, and we start, you know, like, we start equating that lifting him up has to do with some song we sing. See, when he talks, so let's break it, that word exalt, break it down a little bit. What exalt mean, when you talk about lifting up, what are you lifting up? You're lifting up his will. You're lifting up his word above you. You're exalting him above what you think, what you feel, and above what you see. You're lifting him to the place that when life hits you, you don't respond or react the way life hits you. You respond according to his word. That's exalting him. When you are at your worst point of life, let's say you're angry at somebody, you're walking in unforgiveness, because you exalt him, you go back to his word and handle it the way the word says to handle it. That's exalting God. It's when I become less and he becomes more. What John said of Jesus, when they were talking about, you know, everybody's following Jesus, John, what you going to do? And John's response to that was, I understand my place. I understand what I'm called to do. He must increase so that I may decrease. Or I must decrease that he might increase. He understood his role. And a lot of times we don't understand our role. Now listen, and the reason why we don't understand our role is because he hasn't been exalted. See, what many people do, even believers, is we exalt ourselves and then expect God to get behind us and lift us up. No, what we do is we get behind God and lift him up, and even as we are lifting him up, he then lifts us up.
Yes.
That's what it means to exalt God.
All right,
has nothing to do with just what you sing, has nothing to do with how well you can hit every note. It has to do everything with your submission to live your life according to his word and his standards. That's exalting. And it's not. Let me give you a real simple definition of exalting. Obedience. Just obey what he says. That's exalting God. When your yeah but turns to a yes Lord, then you've exalted God.
Come on.
Come on, amen, hallelujah. Now let's talk about praise for a minute. The word praise there in Isaiah 25:1. It means, it's yada. It literally means to just shoot up your hands, to lift your hands. So listen to this. So have you ever been so excited about something, you just lifted up your hands, you just, woo! I mean, you know, come on, let's be real, like football. When our team is down, and it looks like they're going to lose. There you go. That's exactly what we do. But listen, why do we have that emotional expression? Because we are thankful for what we have seen. Come on. Why do we not shoot up our hands when we come into the house of God and just woohoo, glad to be here? Why? Because maybe we haven't seen nothing we've been wanting to see.
Say that.
Come on, man.
Keeping it real. Amen. Keeping it real with you. Keeping it real. Amen. So you cannot, this is, you cannot effectively praise him until you first exalt him. Mm-hmm. Praise, listen, praise without exaltation is like trying to drive a car with no engine. Mm-hmm. Come on. Mm-hmm. Think about it. You can't praise until you exalt. Because if your praise doesn't come out of the fact that through your obedience you've seen God move,
uh-oh,
then where your praise coming from?
Because
it might just be coming from your emotions. And you know, emotions are finicky things. They change like the weather, don't they?
You say that, man.
Change like the wind, amen. But so if I'm going to praise God, I got to first exalt him. I've got to exalt his word. I've got to exalt his will. Listen, because what happens when I exalt his word and his will? If I'm consistent in that, I begin to see God move on my behalf. And then, listen, when I see God move on my behalf, it creates in me a testimony. And then when I come into the house of God and somebody stands there, isn't God good? My hands just shoot up because I've got a testimony of the fact that I've exalted God and I saw his miraculous and wonderful power working in my life.
Amen.
Come on. Come on, amen. Amen. See, you wonder why people not happy? They're not exalting God.
Amen.
Keeping it real. That's why folk not happy. You know why folk complain about life situations and stuff? Because they're not exalting God.
Amen.
Come on, if I exalt God, then that means he becomes the one who is at the forefront of my sight.
Yeah.
And when I compare God to anything else, if he's exalted,
uh-oh,
then everything else looks like nothing compared to who he is.
Yeah.
The problem is we're not exalting him, we're not lifting him up above. See, when we get a problem, we start talking about the problem.
Have a little talk with Jesus and we'll tell them all about our troubles.
Yeah, you keep doing that if you want to, but until you exalt him,
mm,
you will never see victory.
All right, God.
See, because why? Because there's going to always be problems, y'all. There's going to always be life situations that come at you.
Say that.
But there is an answer to every situation, and his name is Jesus.
Amen.
His name is Jesus.
Yes.
Come on, then, amen.
Amen.
He has made you, come on, he has made you the head and not the tail.
Hallelujah.
He has placed you above and never beneath.
Amen.
He says you can do all things through me who strengthens you.
Amen. Yes.
Ooh, glory to God. That's who you exalt. So you gotta start exalting, who he says you are. See, the more you understand who you are, the more you can do. Think about it. How many times have we limited ourselves because we looked at what we had in our hands?
Mm. Mm-hmm.
I don't have enough. I only got 5 of those 2 fish. That's all I got. But that little boy did one thing that we should all do. He presented his 5 loaves and 2 fish, and he gave them to Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
Take your little, and it may not look like much, but give it to Jesus.
Come on.
Because when Jesus get through blessing it,
oh Lord,
that 5 loaves, 2 fish will feed 5,000 men, not including women and children.
Mm-hmm.
Come on, amen. So what is that? That's exalting him.
Mm-hmm.
I don't look at my not enough. I look at his more than enough.
Amen.
Glory to God.
We limit what we do because we look at what we have in our house. No, we're not. We were adopted into the family of God, into his house, mm-hmm, and in his house, he not broke.
Amen.
You don't need it in your hands when you don't need it. You only need it in your hands when you need it, don't you? Isn't that true? But aren't we the type of people that we got to have it in our hands before we can believe God?
Come on.
Lordy.
No, sometimes every time you got to believe God before you see it.
Say that.
Amen. Glory to God.
Whoa.
This is, an individual will never be excited about praising the Lord if in their exaltation of God, they have not seen him do anything for them.
Mm-hmm.
Listen, and this typically happens when an individual is impatient. You know, we want to rob God for 20 years, then we tithe 1 week, and we expect God to turn it all around.
Come on.
Just turn it all around. In 1 week, God will turn it all around. Because even I've been unfaithful for 20 years, so I'm bad seed, but I expect God to turn it around in 1 week. No. Then they say, well, I tried that, but it didn't work. No, it does work. But guess what? You can't plant a garden until you first pull up the weeds.
Yeah.
I don't know about you, but I had a whole lot of weeds in my garden. And there was no need in trying to, look, there was no need in trying to, anybody ever had a garden?
Mm-hmm.
Anybody, like, you like gardening? Is it good, fun? Let me ask you a question. When you first started, there were weeds there, wasn't it?
Yeah.
There were things you had to dig up. Let me ask you, wasn't that hard work?
Yeah.
It's work, man. It's like, woo. You got to gather with a pitchfork, turn it, and especially the ground is hard. You got to pitchfork and turn it over, step on it. Will, you look at me like you don't know what I'm talking about.
You're like, that's pretty rough.
It's pretty rough. It's pretty hard. It's pretty hard. And but you can't plant anything until you first. Then you got to get the little rake, right? And you got to go through the ground, and you got to till up. And you got to keep getting all the little weeds out. You keep getting all of, and what you're doing, you're not only getting the weeds out, but you're also softening up the ground.
Right.
You're actually adding oxygen to the soil to make it healthy again. Mm-hmm. See, what we want to do, we want to skip all of that, mm-hmm. and we want to go into the weeds, throw in the seed, and expect a full harvest.
All right.
It's work, man. This life for Jesus is work. It's a good work if you learn to appreciate the end result of gardening, you will enjoy it.
Yes.
But if all you do is look at the process, you ain't gonna quit planting no garden. You gonna quit halfway through it because you don't have an end result that you're trying to get to. Come on, having an effective praise life is because you have an end result that you see, and it's not what you made up; it's what God said. God is not obligated to bless our plants. He's obligated to bless his plant.
Yeah.
This is, all right. So look at Psalm 34. Psalms 34. We'll look at verse number 1 through 3. And this is a Psalm of David. Psalms 34, starting at verse number 1. Now, here's what it says. This is Psalm of David. He says, I will bless the Lord at all times. I will bless the Lord at all times.
Say that.
I will bless the Lord at all times. At all times. All the time. I will bless the Lord.
Yeah, yeah.
And now let me ask you a question. Did David always bless the Lord at all times? No, he didn't. Read some of his Psalms about his complaints about the enemy and the things that people were doing against him.
Mm-hmm.
He started out saying, man, Lord, you know what? It ain't right what they're doing to me. You know, when they had problems, I was there for them. Now they're attacking me. When they needed my assistance, I was there to assist them. Now they're coming against me. He wasn't blessing the Lord at all times in the sense that he did not have situations in his life that he didn't like. But if you ever keep reading, every time he had a complaint, he always came back with an answer. But Lord, you for me. Glory to God. Amen. So you might start out with a complaint.
Yeah.
But you better end up with a praise.
Amen.
And the only way David was able to end up with a praise was because in the midst of their attacks, he began to, but wait a minute, I remember, God, how you did this for me. And I remember this, and I remember that, and I remember how you were there for me. And though 1,000 may fall at my side and 10,000 at my right, I realize it should not come nigh my dwelling. What did he do? He came to the place of understanding that regardless of what I'm going through, if I learn to exalt God and see the good that is in God, then he'll get me through this too.
Yes.
Praise Amen. God. And I'm telling you, if you learn to see the good and whatever you're going through, you'll get it. Let me tell you, there ain't nothing good in it. There is something good in it. God.
Yes.
Ain't nobody gonna shout myself. See, there's one good that's in every situation you face in life. It's God. God is, he said, I'll never leave you, and I will never forsake you. He said, Lord, I'm with you always, even until the end of this age. Come on, you got something to shout about. Listen, not because of the problem, but because you know you got the problem solver with you in the problem.
That's good right there. Come on. I like that right there.
Well, you know,
come on down that street.
Get enough trouble.
Yeah.
Get enough trouble. I can guarantee your praise will change. You'll start exalt. You know, you'll exalt God when you ain't no more options. come on, hallelujah. You know, everybody run to church when they have no more solutions.
Come on.
When all their plans fail, then they run to God.
Say that.
Loudest one on the front row.
Say that.
But you don't, listen, we don't want to wait till we get to that point.
No.
We want to live there every day of our lives just with an expectation that God is good to me.
Yes.
Come on, God got me. God don't want to be the last thing you run to. He don't want to be the last resort. He's going to be your first resort.
Amen.
Well, amen. And your second resort, your third resort. But he wants to be your only resort. Amen. So David said, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth.
Yes.
Now think about this. If he's going to bless the Lord at all times, that means in order to get to a point where he can bless the Lord, he got to first remember.
Mm-hmm.
Come on. How much rehearsing do you do over the things God has done for you?
Lord.
I mean, seriously, how much time do you actually spend around meditating on what God has done?
Bring it up,
I'm telling you, man, I love your Don't Know story. Awesome. I tell it to everybody, Will. Everybody know that story. You know why? Because it blesses me. Because if God cares about a donut in somebody's life,
yes,
my God, he surely cares about the other stuff.
Mm-hmm.
I tell that story more than I tell you. You probably tell it. I tell it all the time. I tell that donut story every single time. And every time I'm at work and I'm thinking about something, I need something to eat, but I don't have time to go out, I start believing God. I said, God, if you can give Will a donut, praise that you can give me some food. But you know what? Every single time, somebody give me some food. Why? I'm living off his testimony.
Lord.
Mm-hmm.
The Bible said we're supposed to share our testimony with one another, encourage one another, build each other. Shoot, boy, that donut got me a lot of meals. I'm telling you now. It has. Better me sit around, I ain't got what I'm going to eat. I don't know what I'm going to eat. No, God got me. If God has Will's donut, then praise the God got me too. Because
yes.
He is no respecter of persons.
Mm-hmm.
Praise God. Hallelujah. He said, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. You say, well, Pastor, how can I praise God? I got to do a job. I got work. I got responsibility. How can I praise God at all the time? Keep your mind set on him.
Mm.
You know, you can think about God in the midst of your hectic day at work.
Mm-hmm.
You can think, man, you know, well, you just have a conversation. Lord, this day is really kind of rough. But you know what? I'm glad to know you're with me in it. You can strengthen me for this. I just want to praise you. Take a minute to praise you and thank you that you're with me. Lord, these people are getting on my last nerve today. Man, they're driving me nuts today. Lord, but I thank you. Because I know there was a time I got on your nerves too.
Amen.
And you were patient with me. Amen. And you were long-suffering. So Lord, just thank you for the grace to smile at them when I just really want to hit them.
Right.
Hey, come on, amen.
That's
keeping it real. Because nobody's walking around with this yippee-doo-doo-dah happy all the time. But you know what? Like Paul, I can think myself happy.
Come on.
I can get to one side. No, wait a minute. God good to me.
Come on.
When they're telling us at work, oh, you're going to have a hard week next week. I said, praise the Lord. I'm built for hard work.
Glory.
Come on, amen. You don't even approach it with a negative attitude.
Say it.
I will bless the Lord what?
Yeah, all the time.
Thank God I got strength to do a job.
Amen.
Because I know some people that would love to get out of their sick beds and go do a job.
Lord, right. Say that.
Amen. I'm thankful, praise
say
God. Now look what he said. He said, my soul shall make her boast in the Lord.
Mm.
Now what's the soul? It's the mind. You need to rehearse what God's done for you.
Oh,
I remember, I got testimony, y'all. I remember y'all stuff. I probably remember than y'all do. Why do I remember y'all stuff than y'all do? Like, I remember Carrie used to have migraine headaches. I remember. Have you ever had another one?
Mm-mm.
Look at that. How long ago was that? That was about, 7 years ago? Six? We was at Webster.
We were at Webster.
Yeah, and I remember her husband said, Pastor, you got an asthma for what? He said, Carrie got a headache. You can feel like you're coming down with a migraine. I said, oh, no, she's not. That's woman praying.
Glory.
Not even thinking. Just woman praying in the name of Jesus. Because I used to suffer with migraine headaches.
Mm-hmm.
So when people talk about migraine headaches, I got faith with migraines. Come on, amen. And she's never had a... That's awesome. You know how many people need to hear that?
Amen.
See, because some people may have migraines, some people may have knee pain.
Mm-hmm.
But whatever it is, people need to know that God is still a healer.
Yes, he is.
He's not, listen, he's not a temporary fix.
Come on,
He's a permanent fix for you.
Oh, thank you.
But never had another one. Haven't even thought about it. Probably forgot you had them, did you?
I almost had one time, and it just immediately went away.
Come on, amen. No, can't have that. No, I remember you were cast out, can't come back. No, do not receive that in Jesus. Because his what? No, it's funny you said that. I'm sorry, I'm just having conversations with you now. But I was standing in my office today, and I'm thinking, well, Lord, why are you giving me this right now? I'm supposed to be preaching on this. But you just said that because when I was in my office, the Lord said this to me. He said, there are people that want things cast out. They want their house blessed, and then they want you to come and bless their homes and stuff. And the Lord says, don't. He said, even if you bless the home, if they don't get it off of them, it will come back anyway.
Lord.
Say that.
Sometimes the thing, the reason why the thing is in the house is because it's on you.
Ooh.
And if you don't, he said, what they're doing is allowing that thing to come back and reattach itself. So even though you can cast it out, it's going to come right back because they haven't changed their behavior that's allowing it in the house. Mm-hmm. And that's the thing you need to realize. Even if something gets cast out, the Bible said those spirits come back. Mm-hmm. And they want to see if they still have a place.
Mm-hmm.
And if they find out that they have a place, the Bible said not only will he enter in, but he'll bring seven more stronger than himself. Mm-hmm. And so he said your latter state will be worse than your former state. Mm-hmm. So sometimes it's best not to cast stuff out.
Wow.
Because you'll just make them worse. Because I used to pray for everybody that got sick. They had sin, they prayed for it. I started talking to folk. Mm-hmm. Well, what's causing this? Where's it coming from? And you know, what did the doctor tell you? And you know why I ask those questions? Mm-hmm. Because what people want, they want to be free from stuff, but they don't want to change their behavior that's causing mm-hmm. them to be robbed of the freedom.
Right.
And so now I'm like, wait a minute. But if your doctor said you don't need to be eating that, why are you still eating that?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Come on.
Because see, if I pray for you and you get better, you'll get worse because you're not changing your behavior. Mm-hmm. Remember the woman who got caught in a very act of adultery?
Mm-hmm.
Like she was by herself, you know. She really wasn't. but remember what Jesus said to her at the end of all that when he rolled in the ground and everybody was ashamed and went away? He said, woman, where are your accusers? He said, Lord, there are none. He said, neither do I condemn you. But what does he say? But go and sin no more. Why? Because he knew that something worse would happen to you if you go back to the thing that you came to me to get delivered from.
Mm.
So even Jesus expected you to change your behavior.
Amen.
He expected her to change her behavior. Or something worse would happen.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
All right, that's just my little side note there. Amen.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So let's talk about how did Jesus Christ show forth praise? Because think about this, if praise is really a song, why don't we have any records of him singing? If that's how, because that's what we've done today. We've made praise just about music, worship about. It's not. I'm not putting down singing. But I think we turn singing into a god, and it's not. We make it all about, and that's praise the Lord. How about let's exalt the Lord first? Oh, we can't get time to pray. Hold up. How we go praise the one that we're not willing to exalt?
Mm-hmm.
That's not possible. So I start asking the question, how did Jesus praise? How did he actually, because isn't it true the Bible said that God is trying to conform us into the image mm-hmm. of his son? In other words, God said, I want to make you just like Jesus. So then, now, do I praise? Yeah, I mean, I sing songs of praise. But I understand that's not what praise is. In other words, that's not valid until there's some exalting. And I cannot move forward in God with a song alone.
Mm-hmm.
I have to be obedient first.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So look at Philippians chapter 2, verse 5. I mean, go to John chapter 14 first. The Gospel of John chapter 14. And we'll look at verse number 31. And we're going to just look at how the Father perceived that Jesus was one who praised him. John chapter 14. Verse 31, last verse in that chapter. How many believe that praise has to come out of love?
Amen.
Everyone, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Give me a little loud amen. Y'all talking, give me a loud amen.
Amen.
I'm up here sweating for y'all. Give me a good amen.
We love you, Pastor. We love you.
Thank you. Praise the Lord. No.
Love
All right.
you.
John chapter 14, verse 31 says this. And here's what Jesus said. But that the world may know that I love the Father, and as the Father gave me commandment, even so I do. Arise, let us go hence. And what arise mean? Let's start moving. But he didn't start moving until he got the word of the Lord and had made up his mind to be obedient. So then listen, if you don't make up your mind to hear from God, obey, you cannot move forward. It is impossible. We used the analogy Wednesday night about the hamster in the cage. Y'all remember the hamsters in the cage? house and the cage go round and round. The house, well, y'all weren't here. If you weren't here, you don't know. But we were talking about how the hamster, I used to have hamsters. And he would get on that little wheel, that little brick, he would chee 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 chee, and he would just be chee 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 chee, and he would be running, you hear that thing squeaking all down, then you hear a goop 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 goop, he gets some water, he'd get back on the wheel, chee chee chee, and he'd hit him all night long. But guess what I said, when we got up in the morning, guess what the hamster was, with all that running? Still in the cage. There's a whole bunch of folk in church running around, they still in the cage, still in bondage. Come on, amen.
Amen.
Sweating. Getting water, I'm gonna have a good time. We had a good time this morning. Good time. But their lives don't change. Their location doesn't change. Their mentality doesn't change. How many of you know people have been going to church, same church for years and years, and they still think the same way they did 10 years ago?
Yeah.
Isn't it pretty sad when you, because now you kind of have a benchmark, because you can look at yourself and say, well, I mean, when I was at that same point, they still there. And it's like, doggone. I don't want to live like that.
Wow.
Sing the same songs. Got the same wood paneling on the church. Nothing changes. You ever stepped in the church and thought you went back in time?
Mm-hmm.
Like, what in the world? And you kind of want to back out, but you can't because you know you probably got some obligation to be there. But you think to yourself, man, people change. And people think how they're running. They're running on the wheel. They're going somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
But they're not. You come back 20 years and they still in the cage.
Lordy.
Still running on the same wheel. Still not making any progress.
Jesus.
But praise the Lord, we're having a good time in Jesus. Mm. Jesus called you to progress forward.
Mm.
Not to be on the same wheel running like a hamster in a cage. Mm. Drinking water, think you're doing something. God wants us to move forward, praise God. Mm. You know what? Sometimes you got to open up the cage door, throw out the wheel and run and get on the real ground and start running full steam ahead so you can get somewhere. But most people like their cage because it's convenient. You know, I can run a little bit, drink a little water, get my little pellets, I can go back on with, and you know, it's safe. Isn't it true we like being safe?
Yes.
But you know what Jesus never promised us? Safety. He said, all they that live, God, it will suffer. The disciples, a lot of the disciples died horrible deaths.
Oh Lord.
They were boiled in oil, they were beheaded, they were ran through with spears, Peter was, they said, recorded, was crucified upside down. I mean, though, we don't like that. We want to think about the good, happy Christian with the blue skies and the green grass and the trees and the birds singing, but there's a part of suffering that comes with being a Christian. All they live God was suffering. And sometimes the greatest suffering you're going to have to deal with is you.
Say that.
Trying to change your flesh.
Say that.
Your flesh, boy, I think, well, the Bible says you are sealed with an enemy.
Mm-hmm.
Called your flesh.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know why people want to keep identifying with flesh. Man, please, that's why we hate each other now, because of flesh.
Come on.
Mm-hmm.
The Bible says there's nothing good in it. You want to know something that is still the black church prays real fast? That there'll be some persecution going on the black folk.
Uh-huh.
They lose their praise.
That's right.
Now we got a rally.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Block traffic.
Come on.
Amen.
They
do.
Up.
And it's like, hold up now.
Yeah.
Jesus never intended for us to lose our joy.
No.
Amen.
Lord, it's not fair. It's not fair. Look at the cross. It's not fair.
Say that.
Nothing about the cross, nothing about the scourging that he went through, nothing about the beating.
Right.
It was, none of it was fair.
Come on.
But guess what? In his defense, he spoke not a word.
Thank you.
Didn't say a thing. Why? Because he said, because I know this is for a greater good.
Mm.
We don't like to think about suffering like that, do we? Sometimes the suffering is for the greater good.
Hallelujah.
Do you know? Let me.
Oh my God, you
ever heard of a book called The Blood of the Martyrs?
Yes.
It's called The Blood of the Martyrs, and how these guys would go into these like these jungles and find these natives, and they would try to share the gospel with them. Many of them gave their life.
Amen.
To get the gospel to these little native tribes.
Yeah.
Died doing it. But was someone I remember someone saying that when he said, but when a martyr shares their blood for the cause of Christ, God is obligated to not waste that blood. Mm. And he keeps sending them and sending them and sending them. And I was watching a video one time of one of these natives, and he was talking about how the guy came and they killed it. Ran through with spears. And he said, but the fact that he said, the way he died, they said that the guy was saying how, he said he was a little boy too, he said, but he remembered, he said, the way the spears were made, they were edged, so that if you put them in, you can't pull them out. I mean, they're made to tear. Mm-hmm. And he was taking those spears, he was pulling them out. Mm-hmm. And he wasn't cussing them out, he wasn't yelling or anything. He was just pulling them out. And I said, you know, myself, man, we get mad because, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. for whatever reasons in this nation.
Lord.
But there are people that give their lives for the cause of Christ. And rejoice in it. Moving forward. It didn't look like he was moving, like he went down to the ground. No, he was moving forward. Why? Because every time somebody gave their life for the cause of Christ, guess what God did? He kept sending people. Because he was not going to let any believer's death be in vain. Never. See, you got something to praise God for, because you ain't never had to know Amazon jungle.
Say that.
Okay, man. God called you here. Thank you, Lord, I'm here. This is God Christ. Hallelujah. All right, so Jesus said this. He said, John 14, 31, but the world may know that I love the Father, and as the Father gave me command, even so I do. That was his praise to God. That whatever the Lord told me to do, I do it. What was he doing? He was exalting, and he was praising. Well, how was he praising? We didn't read anything about praising. He was praising because everything he did was with the intent to glorify God. Mm-hmm. And he let everybody know he was doing with the intent to glorify the Father. All right, look at Philippians chapter 2, verse 5. Now that was Jesus' state of mind when it came to praise. Praise to the Father. Do what he says. Whatever he tells me to do, I do. That's exaltation. Mm-hmm. And then when he said, "Let arise, let us go in," that was moving forward. Let us go do what the Father said to do. In Philippians chapter 2, verse 5, here's what it says of us. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of what?
No reputation.
He was not out trying to make a name for himself. Now, how many people do you think do stuff in the kingdom of God that do it with the intent to make a name for themselves? Mm-hmm. I'm trying to build up my ministry. That's the problem right there. It's yours.
Mm. Yeah, come on.
That's the problem. It's yours. Yeah. As long as it's yours, it's not God's.
Mm-hmm. Right.
This is in verse 7. But made himself of no reputation and took upon him the form of a servant. Mm. Now, what does a servant do? He serves someone else's will. Are you a servant? Yeah. Do you serve someone else's will? Come on, that's exalting God. Listen, and was made in the likeness of men. In other words, he gave up his godly deity, came down as a man, listen, for us. Now let me ask you a question. Does that look like a downgrade? Mm-hmm. It looks like a downgrade. Listen, when Jesus started out, he was in heaven, in all of his glory. Mm-hmm. And he laid down all that glory to step out to this earth to become like mortal man. Mm-hmm. Oh, that was it looked like a downgrade. But it wasn't a downgrade. It was a temporary situation that was going to bring about a greater good. Let me help y'all with something. Sometimes what you see as a downgrade in your life is really a turning where God is saying, I'm going to do something great with you. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, I lost that job. I love that job. I mean, I was making $60,000 a year. I really liked that job. I lost the job. I got laid. What am I going to do? Making something better out of you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you see money, but I'm looking at character.
Well, right now.
And what you saw as a downgrade was really an upgrade for you because I upgraded your character through this downgrade. Mm. And what's more important to God, character or money?
Come on.
Character.
Come on. Sometimes you have to lose stuff to get it. But the thing, when you get it again, you get it better because your character is better. Come on, man, I hope I'm helping somebody.
Yeah.
See, this is how you got to move forward.
It's helping me.
See, the lie of people think that if God blessed me, I should be going up, 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 and up. And I should never go down. I should be going up. Tell Joseph that. Tell that to Joseph. Tell that to Paul. Tell that to the disciples who all died horrendous deaths, other than John, the one whom Jesus loved, was the only one that had a long life. Tell that to them. But guess what? There's 12 thrones in heaven for each of them. They may have faced a downgrade down here, but when they stepped into eternity, guess what? They entered into their upgrade. And guess what? What they got in heaven will never be taken away from them.
Come on.
Glory to God.
Glory.
All right, listen. Verse, let me keep going. I'm almost done. Y'all doing okay?
Yes.
All right. Verse 8, it says, and being found in fashion as a man, he did what? He humbled himself. So don't be praying, God, humble me. Lord, humble me. Lord, humble me. God can't humble you. You got to do, that's a self-will thing. You got to humble you, which means what? You got to exalt God. You got to humble yourself and exalt his will. And that's what Jesus did. He humbled himself and he exalted the Father's will above his own. That's why in the Garden of Gethsemane, when he knew that his time was short, he said, Father, if it's all possible, let this cup pass from me. That's my will. But however, not my will, but your will be done. In other words, if I got to go to the cross, and this is the only way this can get done, then I'll go to the cross. He wasn't looking forward to it. There's a lot of things we don't look forward to. We do it because it's necessary for the kingdom's sake. Listen, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. But look at the, come on, here comes the upgrade, y'all.
Glory.
It says, wherefore, God also has highly exalted him. Come on, think about it. He was highly exalted, he was downgraded into the earth, but then he was highly exalted again because of his obedience of what he did in the earth to the Father. It says, wherefore, God has highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name.
Amen.
Now listen to this. He didn't have that title before he came. He didn't get that title until after he came to the earth as a downgrade, obeyed God in the downgrade, and God said, I'm going to upgrade you to another level. God. That's why you should never look, just because something don't work out the way you think it should, don't be down on yourself because it does. See, you might be in line for a promotion with the downgrade. Because the downgrade is going to prove your character. Mm. The Bible says Jesus learned obedience through the things he suffered. Mm. I don't want to hear about suffering. Just bless me, Lord. Bless me. Yeah, I'll bless you. I'll let you go through some suffering to reveal your character to you. Mm-hmm. Now listen. Wherefore God has highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of things in heaven and things in earth, and things under the earth. And that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord.
Yes.
To the glory of God the Father.
Amen.
So guess who got promoted to running everything? Jesus did. He wasn't running everything before he came to the earth. He running it, but listen, he running everything now. The Bible says he's seated on his throne. On the mercy seat. Mm-hmm. And you know why God is merciful to us? Because when man do something crazy, and God in his righteousness has never walked in that position, what he can do is he can look to the Son. And the Son said, I understand him. I got him. He's the priest.
Praise God.
He understands. See, Jesus understands everything that you deal with. Every suffering you go through, he knows what it's like.
He went through it all.
Come on, amen. But he came out victorious, which means you can too.
Praise God.
Come on, amen. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
And listen, he doesn't rule and reign for his own. He doesn't rule and reign for his own will. He rules and reigns, talking about Jesus, for the glory of the Father.
Amen.
So if God blessed you today, why would you rule and reign? Would you rule and reign to prove to people that you made it? Would you rule and reign to say, you know what, look what I've accomplished? Would you rule and reign just to say, well, no, God loves me? Or do you rule and reign for his glory? That's a whole big difference.
Come on.
You got to rule and reign for his glory. See, you know, I could pastor for myself. You know, I could pastor and, yeah, you know, I can brag. I'm a pastor. Give me the front row seat. I'm a pastor. Mm-hmm. I could do that. But I don't do it for me.
Look at that.
I do it for him. Amen.
Amen.
I do it for him, not because of me, not because of something I want. I just want him to be glorified. I want you to walk out of here today thinking with the understanding that God loves me, and I'm going to praise him all the way through, and praise God at the end of my life. I can look up and know that God has been there for me 24/7, 365 days a year. He loves me. I tell people, I don't care if you remember my name. I don't even care if you remember where you get the word from. As long as you get the word, that's the most important thing. But praise is the key to all that. It's important to moving forward, to be able to thank God and to lift him up and say, Lord, you know what? I know you love me. I know you got me. And if you tell me to do something that don't make sense to me, I don't have to understand it because I trust you.
Look at that.
If you tell me to give a certain amount that I think to myself, oh, my God, no, I'm going to go trust you. I'll worry about it later. Because you know if you think about it too long, you'll talk to yourself about obeying God, won't you? Have you ever done that? You ever talked to yourself? God told you to do something. You start rationalizing it. Well, they don't like, they need that. They look like that. They might be looking that way because they by faith saying, I'm believing God to get back to this level again.
Say that.
See, we rationalize things away. Mm-hmm. But we got to exalt God's word and his will above our own. And not try to figure out and understand. You don't have to understand everything. Because let me tell you, in this world, you will not understand everything. Mm-hmm. But you know what you can do? You can trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not to your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge him, and he will do what? Direct your path. He said, I'll show you where I'm taking you. Just stick with me. Amen? But in the process of following God, listen, praise him. Give him glory for who he is. Tell him how awesome he is. And I tell people all the time, I don't care if you share that testimony 25,000 times. Share it 25,001 times.
All right.
Because you know what? I may get tired of hearing it. People might get tired of hearing it. But guess what? God never gets tired of hearing it. And the only one you're trying to please is him.
Amen.
I mean, come on, amen.
Yes.
And if you show God that you're thankful for what he has done, guess what? He is more willing to give you more. Because the intent of blessing you is that you might share it with other people. God ain't blessing quiet people who don't want to tell what he's done. Mm-hmm. He's trying to get glory back to his name. Amen? All right, let me stop. Praise God. I want to encourage you in that. Praise an important key to moving forward. You got to praise God.
Yes.
Exalt him with your obedience and then praise him for what he's done. Amen? Hallelujah. Father God, we thank you for the word and we thank you for your people. And we just pray, Father God, that even as we walk through this week, Lord, we just pray that you would help us to keep that at the forefront of our mind, to be able to exalt your word and your will of God.
Lord.
And that through that exalting of allowing you to be God, that through those blessings that come through our obedience, that we can praise you because of the testimony that you've given us because of your faithfulness.
Yes.
We declare, Father, that we love you, we thank you, and we just give you the glory.
Lift you up.
In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Praise God.